listen on your... it reminds us every year why we do it. We've helped over 2,000 families now, and the money stays right here in Ulster County. I think that's why we've been so fortunate to get so much support over the years.
Right, yeah, because it all does stay local, and we wish there wasn't a need, but there is, unfortunately. I see you're wearing your Tommy Keegan Have Fun, Play Nice bracelet that I think Keegan Army's selling as part of the fundraiser.
Yeah, actually,
waiting list, so I don't have mine.
We were all on Cape Cod, our family, and just talking about, you know, all the great things that Tommy came up with over the years, and the wristbands came up, and my sister Megan said, you know, we should do something with those. And I said, well, why don't you contact, she's friends with some people in Keegan Army. I said, why don't you contact Tracy and see what, you know, she says. And by the time I'm back from the Cape, people are saying, hey, you need a bracelet. So yeah. They've sold like 200 and something.
I know. I'm on the wait list.
So it's great. But, you know, we were talking before we came on, watching the community come together on that and a lot of other things recently is, you know, a good sign to see that, you know, that's what makes Kingston what it is.
This is true. And what else is going on? How else has Kingston come together? Do you have more news for us?
Yeah, you know, I was thinking about this yesterday, and it was a very hot topic button about the rescue vehicle that Kingston was going to partner with the town of Ulster on, and it was being misconstrued in certain aspects of the public as to what exactly this vehicle is. It's not an army tank. It's a true rescue vehicle for days like today. And many people banded together, went, spoke publicly. I was asked to go and speak. I just wasn't available that night. But really happy to see so many people stand up and push back against a small group of very loud people that, quite frankly, they're not helping anything. And the people spoke and won. So I commend everybody that was got involved in that. And it's not always easy to go to a public forum and speak. I've done it before and you never know what to expect. Mm-hmm. But I think if you believe in what you're standing up for and it is the right thing, which in this instance it absolutely was, you can't be silenced by a small group of people. And it was a wide variety of people too. So it was really good to see. I think that's what Kingston needs right now. A lot of positive things can't be swallowed up by some small negative people that, you know, quite frankly, if you're that unhappy, why are you here?
True. Yeah.
What's new with you?
Great place to be. Oh, not too much. We're actually working on the general election already at the office. So
Hard to believe.
It's going to be November soon. But yeah, we're getting our election inspectors on board because there's like close to 600.
What is election day this year?
November 2nd.
November 2nd, so
it's
early.
And then there's early voting 2 weeks prior. So, yeah. So it starts actually in October if you know, so early voting. And then November 2nd is election day.
So now, there's a lot of local elections this year.
A lot of local, yes. It's not a huge election. It's nothing like last year.
Yeah.
But a lot of local. And you can go to the, you can just Google Board of Elections, Ulster County, and there's all kinds of information on there. Yeah.
So. What are any of the, I mean, I know like the city of Kingston, there's aldermen. Is there any like bigger county ones that people should be paying attention to?
Yeah, lots of town council. I should know, and I don't.
But that tells me there isn't any.
Right, anything.
Because I'm not aware either, so.
Right, yeah.
And I try to.
Some of the bigger ones, I think, are running, like, unopposed, so I think that's why.
Yeah, that typically draws less attention, so right. It'll be.
Ulster County Legislature spots.
That's local. The one I was thinking of that I couldn't think of. Mm-hmm. I know the Timbrook woman is running, which will be interesting. It's nice to see someone step up that's, she's a wife and a mother and putting herself out there in the middle of very, very chaotic political times, which unfortunately seem to be getting more chaotic by the day. Yeah. I commend people like that. We joked previously, people have asked me to run for mayor, and my son thinks I would win, which is a nice endorsement, but it's not going to make me do it. No.
Take that on?
You know, maybe at a later point in my life, but not right now.
Not yet.
I hope somebody steps up. I don't know who that would be at this point, but, it's a big thing. Not only are you putting yourself out there, you're putting your whole family out there.
That's true.
And,
and you're not just talking mayor, you're talking just running for office.
Running for anything, because, right, everything is right here on our phone now.
Yeah.
And that's not always a good thing. And
right, it's a lot.
It takes a lot of courage. It really does. I could see you running for something someday.
I know, yeah. Somebody has to, right?
Well, that's... absolutely.
So where would we be if people didn't stand up for the community? So, yeah. What else do we have going on? We survived without, terrible winds and things here yesterday, which I'm glad about. I think everybody was bracing, but we're good.
Yeah, the hype was there, and then I was following it. Hudson Valley weather, and you could kind of see it just I think on the other side of the river it might have still been pretty bad.
I didn't hear. I actually worked a wedding in Columbia County on Saturday. It was the calm before the storm. They were definitely preparing for a bad day, but I never found out yesterday how that side of the river did. The other side of the river.
Yeah, I haven't received any emails from Central Hudson yet this morning, so...
We seem to be in good shape.
Everybody's okay?
I live down in the Rondout, so my wife said, don't go down to Abil. And, of course, I went down to Abil, and checked it out because I wanted to see how it was. And there's no flooding of any significance whatsoever. A couple puddles just like normal on the road. But, and the Rondout Creek is in good shape, in great shape. It's as usual.
Good.
Yeah.
Yes, I did just drive through there this morning, and it's a good thing they didn't add flooding to the already torn up Abil Street, because it's...
Exactly.
It's entertaining to drive down Abil Street
right
now.
Exactly, with the little pink lines stuff.
Oh, my God.
I was on there Saturday, and I was, just kind of rolling along, not paying attention. All of a sudden, ba-boom, and I'm like, whoa.
Yeah, and it kind of goes on for a while, so it'll be exciting when they get that paved. Lots of paving going on this year.
Oh, wonderful. Absolutely. Yeah, once the infrastructure underneath the streets are finished, then the plan for repaving is imminent.
Yeah, they've been doing a lot of work. I live on Main Street uptown in our neighborhood. They've done a lot of work, which people complain about because it's an inconvenience. I'm like, well, no, the inconvenience is when the sewer line that comes to your house explodes, and then, that's not only a problem for you, it's a problem for your whole block. So.
Right. Yes, exactly. And that would be a longer inconvenience.
Yes, so I'm willing to
take what you got.
Deal with some preventative work than, that happening at 2 in the morning. So.
So this morning we have 7:30 Brian Woltman coming on. Is that correct?
Yep.
Brian's running for Ulster County Legislature again. Is that?
I believe so, yes. We'll find out
when he gets here. Find out more when he gets here at 7:30. 8 o'clock we have Christina from Spa 21, which is right downstairs from Kingston Community Radio. She's coming in to tell us all about Spa 21. We've had her on, I think, once before. Great guest, and a lot of people aren't familiar with all the services available right downstairs here at Spa 21. Have you been?
I have. It's fantastic.
Isn't it great?
Yeah, really. I've unfortunately a lot of back issues from a surgery, and I'm kind of always looking for different things, and that was different but fantastic.
What did you do? There's so many services.
Yeah, so I did a package of a crypto, I think, probably she can correct me when she gets it. It's the sub 200 degree, whatever.
Okay. The cryo-freeze?
Cryo-freeze.
Okay.
Crypto's definitely not the right word.
Okay.
I was little bit apprehensive on that. I'm not a big fan of closed-in spaces.
Oh, but your head
Yeah, your
is
head
out.
Is out. Once okay. I saw it, I was like, okay. Really just, whoa. And then I did a gravity table and then some type of heated, like, bed where just...
Oh, and there was, like, a dome over you?
Totally relaxes you.
Yeah.
And, like...
I did that one, too. I like that
I think
one.
I started... You know, it's like 20 minutes for each. You're basically trying out each. So it's like 20 minutes each or somewhere around there. And like that heated bed thing, I think I fell asleep for a minute because I woke up and I was like, what? Yeah.
Did 20 minutes go by?
I mean, already? My back flares up bad from time to time. And I was in a bad way when I went there. And it was actually in the middle of COVID, you know, in the height of it.
Mm-hmm.
The place was absolutely spotless. Like, second I walked in the door, I'm like, they've got it down here.
Yeah, exactly. I was glad that they were open during COVID because the same thing. Back issues, and that's where I went. And they were really great about, you know, only having limited people. And you never saw anybody else,
yeah.
Even if they were in there for a treatment. And it was spotless. So not your average spa, and we'll learn more at 8 o'clock. And then at 8:30, we have Bob Baum coming in.
Correct.
What's Bob coming in to talk about? Because there's many things he could be talking about. Do you know?
I don't know, but
it's anybody's guess. We're going to find out at 8:30.
Yeah.
And in case you haven't noticed, it's not Medical Monday. So we would love to hear
we're
from
just
any
talking
listeners.
About back issues,
but
though.
Yes.
Yeah, unless you have back issues.
That we could talk about. Yeah. Yeah. So you opted for surgery. I opt to, like, but you still have issues.
Well, I opted for surgery when I had no other choice.
Uh-huh.
And predominantly why I have issues now is because I waited so long.
Oh, interesting.
And so I have some permanent nerve damage that, you know, the surgeon told me when I first went, he said, yes, there's a herniation. If it's not impacting your lifestyle, this was in October, and my favorite thing to do is ski, so I wanted to get through ski season. And I almost did until I skied the day of the 52-inch storm at Plattekill here, and then already had plans to go to Vermont the next day, so left for Vermont, skied 3 days at Stowe, and my leg just shut down on the way home, shut down where I had to pull over like every 20 minutes, get out of the car. And I didn't think I was going to make it home at one point. Mm. I said, you can't put
keep
this
going
up.
Like this. Yeah.
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 So, but Dr. Sandhu Hospital for Special Surgery.
Where is that?
In the Upper East Side.
Okay.
The literally premier thoracic surgeon in the country is phenomenal. And every time I tell somebody to go see him, you know, he's not talking you into surgery.
Right.
He doesn't need to.
Right.
You know.
You either need it or you don't.
Right. And he's the best of the best. And, you know, I tell people it's worth the time to take the drive down there. Right. He's just so thorough. His bedside manner is phenomenal. The facility is, you know, first class. So. Hopefully nobody needs it, but he's the guy to go to if you need to. So hopefully you never do.
Yeah, hopefully.
Yeah, the
not.
Best doctors do say, I don't want to see you again.
Yeah.
I love you, but I don't want to see you again.
Absolutely.
The best doctors do say that.
Very
that's
true.
True.
So before we get busy with our guests, there is something we were asked to talk about, the Kingston Veterans Association. In concert with the Chamber of Commerce and Ulster County Executive Pat Ryan and the Ulster County Veterans Service Agency and Kingston Veterans Association are looking for your help to purchase new uniforms for the VFW Honor Guard. There's a few different ways to help them. They estimate the cost of the uniforms is about $15,000, so they're looking for local businesses and individuals to help the VFW Honor Guard by becoming a sponsor. There's a general level of $1,000 or a captain level of $500. I'm sure they'll accept any other donation that people may be willing to help with. Tax-deductible donation check can be made out to Kingston Veterans Association, KVA, Tension Bill Forte, F-O-R-T-E, Chairman, 249 Linderman Avenue, Kingston, New York, 12401. Or you can email Bill at woogman2001@yahoo.com.
Okay. Thanks for sharing that.
Absolutely. That I think we're light on announcements today, I will say, and I know we generally do birthdays at another time, but I don't know what time that is.
So. Whose birthday is it?
Mr. Bob Ryan Jr.'s 59th birthday today.
Oh, yes. Okay. Happy birthday, Bob Ryan.
So, if you happen to be listening this morning, Bob, I believe you're back from Cape Cod, but happy birthday. I'm still 13 years younger than you.
Always will be. 59. Huh.
Yeah. So, yep. Got to keep that in mind for next year, and it's a big one. But right. In all seriousness, happy birthday, Bob. You do a ton for the community, and fortunate to have you as a friend and cousin. So, most days.
Oh, Bob. Yeah, I feel like without regular events going on, I don't see half as many people. Like, I mean, you seem you're related, but.
I was in Saratoga at the track on Wednesday for an event for work. There's people I hadn't seen in 2 years.
Wow. Yeah, isn't that crazy?
And the track was packed.
Oh.
Like.
And was it hot Wednesday?
It was hot. We were in that new clubhouse for lunch, so that was nice. But
okay,
then,
so yeah, my husband recently went and they had gotten a table, so they all thought it was going to be air conditioned. And then,
it was in the clubhouse, but not the by the rail.
Okay, they were in the covered part, but it wasn't air conditioned. It wasn't inside.
Yeah, we were in the old clubhouse. So if you're looking at the track, the finish line, you go all the way to the right. Mm-hmm. There used to be that big clubhouse building.
Right.
Well, last year they totally renovated it. Oh. It's beautiful. I mean, the food was phenomenal. But then you walked, it was a work event, so we all had blazers on, and you walk outside, and I was out there for like 30 seconds. I'm like, I'll be inside.
I'll be inside.
I don't need to see the horses that closely.
Wow, yeah.
And I didn't win a damn thing, so.
Oh, too bad.
Yeah.
And there's, only 2 weekends left? How many weekends left
do we
know?
This is the last full week. Oh, Travers is
coming up.
Saturday, yeah.
Okay. Oh.
So.
Last chance to get out there. I didn't get up there this year.
Yeah, I was glad I did. It was good to see. How busy it was.
People missed that last year for sure. So,
it's always, I love going up there.
It's always a good time. Yeah.
Good time. It's a great town and, good to see it coming back. So,
yeah. It's what we did for my husband's 50th. It was a good time. We rented a Trailways bus. Thank you, Gene Berardi.
Yep.
And
thank you, Gene.
Packed the bus and headed on up, and it was a great day. And we always say we're going to rent a bus and do it again because that was the way to go, but we haven't done it yet, but we will.
Yeah, I've done that. I've rented Nadine Ferraro's party van, whatever it's called, and took
Enjoy the Ride.
Yes.
Are they still doing Enjoy the Ride?
I don't know.
Nadine, if you're listening, call in and let us know.
Yeah.
Because they've got so much going on.
I know. And I'd love to book you for Saratoga next summer.
There you go.
Yeah, it was great. Her husband dropped us right off, said what time you want to, get picked up. And then, of course, ended up taking a detour on the way home, and he was a good sport about it.
Uh-huh.
And, so it was a lot of fun.
Cool.
But, yeah, if you are into the horses, you've got a week left.
Yeah. Dan, did you get to the track this year?
I didn't, and you guys are enticing me to just get up to Saratoga Springs. Everything that has to offer, it's an incredible area.
Exactly.
And
someday I hope to see the Rondo.
We'll hit it.
I
have a little bit of time off in September, I think. Even though the races might be over, Saratoga Springs and everything else that Saratoga is really worth the trip.
Yeah.
Always is. Yeah.
There's so much to do.
It's a day trip.
It
is.
You
can get there and back in your day. Mm-hmm. And it's a great, great place to arrive.
Yes.
A lot of great restaurants. It's always.
Yeah.
The fall is a great time up there. I've been up there in September quite a few times. And still got that fun feel to it. And
it's usually sunny.
Yeah.
In September, early September and stuff, it's usually pretty sunny. And you were saying something about Rondout.
The Rondout area. I always hope and someday hope that just that stretch on Lower Broadway, the Rondout area, would just become a little mini Saratoga. I mean,
very interesting idea.
Offer, but yeah, I would just love to see that foot traffic and and just all there is to offer.
Well, it is staged to be able to do that. I mean, the parking is very good. Yep. Down in the Rondout along the Strand, the parking is very, very good. You can always park over by where behind the Mariner's Harbor or Ship to Shore.
Right, there's plenty of area. Parking.
Very good parking.
It's scenic. We have great restaurants.
Yeah.
More and more successful shops like Makers. And, yeah, we need a craft beverage place downtown.
Okay, you've put it out there, Fran.
I'm putting it out in the universe. We need a craft beverage place downtown. We do. It's missing.
That would be fun.
Down there.
That's true.
That element is just missing.
And there are still some spaces that are available down there.
There are.
There are.
Yeah, down by Armadillo.
Yeah.
That little strip right there by Armadillo, which also has incredibly extensive parking.
Yep.
Down there. So, it's a great place to
all the way up.
Climb down to when you're living up in Uptown or, used to, town of Ulster and things like that. It's a nice place to go down to.
It's so many. Have you been to the donut shop downtown?
God, I've heard all about it. I better just go.
Just go.
One of these That's a new adventure. No, I haven't.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody's talking about it.
I want to say Half Moon, Rondout. Yeah, the donuts are amazing. They're delicious. It's an old family recipe.
Oh, you had to say so. Okay, I do love donuts. Oh, God.
And you got no excuse. You're right there.
Yeah, exactly. They're you can get plain, but they're like the sugar-coated kind, not the big frosting type of donut. And they make them fresh right when you order them, so they're still hot. Like, we get them even uptown at the office if John brings us up donuts. They're still hot when they get to the office.
Oh, that's like, when Adam sets up the donut stand.
Fran,
right,
that's
walking
just
in.
Wrong. That's
it's
just
like, come
wrong. They're too good
discipline.
That way.
Yeah,
that's like pulling a tomato out of your garden and, like bringing a shaker of salt down with you. That's just, it can't get better than that.
No.
Yes, right. They're still hot.
And oh, look,
nice
they're
and
selling
fresh.
Apple pies. And you're wait, what is going on
here?
Yeah,
they do have a chocolate babka there, too. It's quite delicious. Yeah. Speaking of tomatoes, my tomatoes are not doing well this year, Dan.
Well, it's been raining for 2 months.
I know. Yeah. This was not the season for them, apparently.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a shame.
I think morning sun is advantageous to tomatoes, and our tomatoes are just burgeoning. I brought a couple to the restaurant to use. They're just unbelievable. And I think morning sun, morning warm sun is good for them, and that's all that they really do get. So
I'll have to keep that in
out.
Mind.
It worked out. Anyway, we're going to go to break.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. Thank you. And you are with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio. AM 920 and 92.5 FM. And my name is Dan Gatiss, and it is 7:30 a.m., Monday, August 23rd, and 68 degrees right now here in Uptown Kingston. And this upcoming portion of Kingston Community Radio is going to be brought to you by Central Hudson. We'll be right back after these messages.
Thanks for starting your day with Kingston Community Radio on 920 WGHQ AM Kingston and 92.5 W223 CR FM Kingston, New York. Magic 92.5.
Get ready to go with Central Hudson on an epic adventure at the Dutchess County Fair, August 24th through the 29th. Visit us at our main booth in Building C and say howdy to Zoltar the Fortune Teller, who will predict your energy future. Then pop over to Central Hudson's booth at K29 to score 10 LEDs plus a desk lamp for only $10. See you in Rhinebeck at booths C30 and K29.
Hi, my name is Jackie Lavezzo. I'm from Lake Katrine.
And I support the Kingston Community Radio because it is an invaluable resource to the community and its residents.
Hi, this is Cameron Rylance from Kingston, and I support Kingston Community Radio because it's informative.
And thank you for being with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920, 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. 68 degrees on this Monday, August 23rd. Seems we dodged the bullet. Rain likely, of course, today. Potential for flooding rain still exists. It's a high of 73 today. And some clouds tonight, a slight chance of a rain shower as we move into this evening. Our chance of rain only diminishes down to about 20%. And it's a low of 64. Tuesday, a few clouds from time to time, a high of 89. Looks like it's going to be a little bit of sun tomorrow. And a high of 89. And then Tuesday night, mostly clear, low of 63. And no real chance of rain for Tuesday night either. And let's get back to the on-air studio with Dan Gruner and Fran DePetrillo Savocca. Welcome back.
Morning.
Thanks, Dan. And we have Brian Woltman here with us. Good morning, Brian.
Good morning, Fran and Dan. How are you? Fran and Dan.
Fran and Dan.
That works, the Fran and Dan hour. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Kingston. I just drove up through Kingston. Look like we largely, at least from Midtown Uptown, were unscathed by our storm Henri. Mm-hmm. I guess Henri is a good French name. It tacked over here to Hudson Valley. Maybe our host would know about, our controller would know about. He works at Le Canard. Henri knew there was good French food here, so he made his way over. But anyway,
that's
thanks.
Where I recognize Dan from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I can put that together.
Le Canard.
He was telling us earlier. He lives down on the Roundout, and things are okay down there. And we were saying how we haven't heard, you know. We haven't gotten anything from Central Hudson saying.
No, I didn't get any alerts either. So thankfully,
hopefully.
That's the biggest inconvenience in any of these things when your utilities go out. You know, that's the first line, and then obviously there's thankfully there was no flooding or anything like that, so to speak. Like what we had with Superstorm Sandy back in 2012. I don't know if many people can recall that. The downtown Kingston was. Pretty devastated. There was a section on North Street and where the Kingston wastewater treatment plant was I think like 8 or 9 feet of flooding.
Yeah.
Did millions of dollars of damage to the wastewater treatment plant in Kingston, which is right on East Strand.
Right, so, and Sandy didn't come along that far after Irene, which talk about a Beale Street flooding. We were talking about a Beale Street earlier. That was
Irene. I was without power for 4.5 days. It was you know, the transformer blew up.
Oh.
And, you know, they blew up all over the place. And, you know, Central Hudson, you can only get so many transformers, you know.
Right.
Once you get to a certain point, they had to order them. And that was rough. I mean, thank God Dietz Stadium Diner had power.
Oh, there you go.
And, I mean, but we learned, like, if you weren't there by 7 a.m., forget it.
Oh.
So I'm like, got a 5-year-old kid I'm dragging out of bed.
Your alarm.
We got to eat.
What's going on? Come on, let's go.
Yeah, thank goodness for Dietz Stadium Diner.
I appreciate you having me in this morning.
Yeah.
Some people may know I'm running for the Ulster County Legislature again. I've made a decision to seek returned to the legislature. I served in the legislature from 2018 to 2019. I thought we had a very active 2 years there, and I have to say the 2 years subsequent, I've been rather quiet as I see it in the legislature. I don't think there's been a lot of achievements in the legislature. I mean, prior to that, we had the Bring Your Own Bag law, we had the Tobacco 21 law, we had the argument with the RRA as it related to single stream recycling, and you know, there's a lot of issues, and there's still issues continuing to press Ulster County, whether it be economic development. The county recently received a request for responses to a request for expressions of interest that they put out for the Tech City, the development, future development at Tech City. As some of you may recall, Farm to Table was the tenant out there. In 2019, we were faced with a crisis that the owner, Mr. Ginsburg, chose or apparently wasn't paying his Central Hudson bill and made headlines that Central Hudson was going to cut off the electric out there, and it created an immediate issue for the county because the county was in a position where they were poised to take the property back for lack of payment of taxes. But they were reluctant to do so, and understandably so, because they didn't want to be in the landlord business. But it was the point I made at the time, and I was the chairman of the Economic Development Committee, was that at some point it's reaching a state of critical mass out there. I mean, Mr. Ginsburg, you can only not pay your taxes for so long where there are repercussions for that. And now what was happening was employment was being threatened out there. So we stepped in, and I remember I was having a meeting with Adele Ryder. She was the acting county executive at the time, and her team. And the point was made to her that it's time. It's time to move on this. And thankfully, that set the ball in motion where I think the county is in a good position now to see that property out in Tech City redeveloped. One of the things, I know there's several proposals out there and several interesting proposals. What I would suggest and what want to push for is that whatever occurs out there, that property remain, the future of it, as it goes back on the tax rolls and it's a taxable property and pays property taxes and doesn't leave the county or the town of Ulster exposed in any way. And you might ask, why would a legislator who represents the city of Kingston, wards 6, 7, and 8, be so interested in what's happening out in the town of Ulster? Well, the reality of the situation is that for the greater Kingston area, that particular property out there was our economic engine. And that economic engine has been stalled now for almost 20 years, and we've seen the latent effects of that in our community, whether it be high rates of poverty, which, you know, we're always talking about how great, we hear a lot about how anecdotally, and we see as well, there's a lot of great things happening in the city of Kingston. The fact of the matter remains that the poverty rates in the city of Kingston are still quite high. We have two census tracts in the city of Kingston, 97-21 and 97-20, which the last time I saw the data had over a 50% poverty rate. Now, that's in a city that's supposedly booming. And to have over 50% poverty rate among those people who live in the city of Kingston, that's extraordinary, as I see it, and very troubling. And we need to do what we can to develop a robust economy. And I think getting Tech City back on track and getting something productive in there is would be a great step forward. So hopefully, it's going to take time and patience, but I think we're on the road to having a good future out there. And hopefully, I would like to see to help and assist that come to fruition.
You know, you bring up a good point of, you know, the county taking control of the property. I personally never thought I would see it happen.
No, well.
And, you know, I give County Executive Ryan a lot of credit for doing that because, you know, we all know a bad apple landlord leads to a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you talk about the city of Kingston and poverty and landlord, and, you know, people get excited when you hear these big name people that have a B in front of their net worth, and what have any of them done to improve Kingston? To change, maybe, but to improve it, you know, I'm a lifelong, I moved away for a while, but I grew up here.
As I did.
And I watched my parents' friends, who probably 80% were IBMers, and to watch that go away was devastating. To watch, I'll never forget. It was my first summer working for Merle at the Armadillo when IBM was still here. The line would be down to Beale Street every Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday night. And I'm like, this is complete mayhem. And then IBM closes. She still did very well, but, you know, I was 18 at the time, and I'm like, you know, well, what happened to the line? Well, it's like 4,000 less people living here. But fast forward to, you know, the city of Kingston, you know, and it's come to light lately that Peter Buffett's behind a lot of initiatives in Kingston, some that are very, very controversial. You know, and then the other gentleman I won't mention because he'll probably sue me, who bought up a lot of property uptown. Hey, all those buildings sit vacant. So I'd like to get your perspective on those two things because both, you know, you representing three wards in Kingston. Those, in my opinion, are the two biggest issues in the city of Kingston.
Well, yeah, I'm certainly concerned with the influence that Novo is has asserted in the city of Kingston, and they've done so in a way without without any really public transparency. And by the way, there's a word you hear all the time. I got to interject this. I'll just caution any of the listeners out there. When you hear politicians speak about transparency, beware, because more often than not, when they're speaking about how transparent they want to be, it's how transparent they aren't. And just there's a little cautionary point for the listeners that you won't hear me speak too much about transparency. Not that I don't want to be transparent, but I just want to speak real. Novo Foundation has it's come to light that they've through some reporting and disclosures that they've thrown a lot of money at some very divisive groups here in the city of Kingston, and it's to me troubling. It's I wonder what the long game is. I would expect a foundation that would be as well funded as the Novo Foundation is, and apparently continues to be. What's the long game? What's their long view? What are they trying to ultimately achieve here? And I won't name the group, but a lot of people are familiar with it. But they are really have not been constructive, as I see it, in the city of Kingston. We look what happened not long ago at one of our Common Council committee meetings when they came in and were totally disruptive. And my view, it should never have been allowed to occur. And thankfully, at the full meeting of the Common Council, the city took steps to address the situation. But again, they're fully funded by the Novo Foundation.
Yeah, and I'll say the name so there's no guessing because I'm not running for anything. Mm-hmm. Rise Up Kingston's a political agitator. Yeah, and, you know, I brought that up for a reason because I witnessed everything that took place at that meeting and afterwards. And, you know, I have a 13-year-old son, and he's a very intuitive kid and asks a lot of questions. And we were driving home from a Tay Fisher Summer Series basketball game. And I don't even remember why it came up. Everything that's going on in the world in Kingston and you know, and I said to him, I said, you know, unfortunately we go through these things, right? But I believe good people will win in the end. And if you get up and do the right thing every day and help people when nobody's looking, that's what makes things happen. Some individual who's certainly I've never seen before, so I could strongly argue, is not from the city of Kingston, goes to a Common Council meeting and is giving people the finger to give people the finger with no end game purpose other than to agitate people, that's bad for Kingston.
Yeah, I was at that meeting.
Yeah, and I thank God, and I said to Fran earlier today, I was asked to speak at that meeting. I wasn't available, but thank God so many people did and stood up because I don't know if we are controlled by money, nothing good comes of it. So why are people, they're finally starting to stand up to it. It's taken a long time, but thankfully it has. But, you know, we need a solution to that.
Well, and to add to your point, Dan, Rise Up Kingston and another group in the area, Citizen Actions, they act as political action committees, PACs.
Correct.
yet they're not registered as such. But they endorse candidates, they petition for candidates, they canvass for candidates, and they advocate for them, and they help fund them. But they're not registered as a political action committee. If you go on the New York State Board of Elections website and to find them, you will not. Yet they act in whether if it looks like a duck, quacks like a duck, it's a duck. It's the same deal. While they're not registered as political action committees, they are certainly acting as such in our community.
You might want to have someone look into the nonprofit's filing status.
Well, and there's, as you know, there's always a lag in that, in their disclosures, and that's the interesting part. If you go to look at their 990s, I believe it is, you'll see there's definitely a lag in their disclosures. It's troubling to say the least, but I think people ought to be aware that that these types of organizations are seeking to influence people in the city of Kingston. As it relates to the county and my district, it can be tricky. I mean, the wards 6, 7, and 8 are encompassed. If you look at a map of the city of Kingston, it's a full 1/3 of the city, and so it's a lot of area to cover.
And remind people what are those wards?
Wards six starts over by the Armory Roosevelt Park.
Yep,
it comes across. Albany Avenue and Foxhall by the St. Mary's Cemetery, that area there into Dernbacher Street, Stefan yep. Street. That's where Ward 7 picks up. Ward 7 is where I happen to live, right on Abbey Street, and that continues up over Clifton Avenue area, Highland Avenue, and then go down to First Avenue, crosses 9W down to First Avenue. And then Ward 8 picks up on the avenues. It's kind of interblended there, I should say. And then Ward 8 is probably the area, Ward 8 is probably the, one of the biggest areas, wards that you have, because it's the Pinkaki. It continues through Lower Broadway, which you're talking about. Yes, and it could be a little bit of Saratoga down there, absolutely. And I love the sidewalk dining, just throwing that in. And it continues up the hill, like where President's Place is. So it's a pretty big district. It's a fair amount of, I know I'll be going through a couple pairs of shoes in the next couple of months, trying to get to it. Everybody's doors, of course, with COVID and the and this Delta variant, people may be reluctant to have people come knocking on their doors, but we certainly will respect that and, point of view, and hopefully we can push through this Delta variant in the next month or so and get people vaccinated and move on with our lives. Because Fran and I did the vaccination side by side, at least the first one. We were side by side in line out at the Best Buy.
Best Buy.
I'll tell you what, that was so well run.
Yes, it was.
Mm-hmm.
My compliments to the executive.
The community benefited from a former Army officer. I didn't know what to expect, and mine was like on a Tuesday at 11 o'clock or whatever. And I mean, my friend who had gone a few days earlier said, she says, "Oh, you'll be in and out of there in 20 minutes," and I'm like, "There's no way." And I'm dreading sitting there, and I'll get annoyed and impatient, and boom, boom, I'm like, "That's it." Go sit here for 20 minutes to make sure you feel okay.
The morning appointment would have been the way to go. Fran and I had a little longer wait.
Yeah, the morning was the way to go.
The morning was the way to go, but
because the line was out the door when we got there.
You know, it was interesting because mine was at like 10:42 or whatever it was. And so, I got the shot. I sat for the 20 minutes, so it's 11:15. There was a line forming.
Uh-huh.
And I had to run into Target to get something. I come out. And then there was a line. And I was like,
But even the size of the line was huge. There were multiple lines, but it was still extremely well-run, efficient. We were in and out.
Is it still at Best Buy? Or
no. Actually, the county just opened a...
one in the plazas.
Down at King's Plaza near Savona's.
Yeah.
Plaza Pizza. I think it has limited... I think it's Friday, Saturdays, I believe. But
Good. It's on the bus route.
Yeah, it is on the bus route. By the way, when I was on the legislature, that's when the city bus and county routes were combined.
Yeah.
And I was, as chairman of economic development, that fell under the committee that I had oversight, that our committee had oversight on that transition. And at the time, it was very important to me that the city of Kingston have its service maximized. And there were a couple deficiencies on the initial routes that the county put through. And I worked with the county executive at the time and the UCAT staff, and we put together both the Hine administration and the Pat Ryan administration. We worked together to add certain routes back to the city of Kingston that were left off, and it was difficult. It was a difficult merger. I still see that there's still some issues with the UCAT as it relates to the city of Kingston, where there's areas where it can be improved, particularly as it services some of the over by Stuyvesant Charter and Colonial Gardens, that area, that they could use some better service. One thing that's interesting, in the county legislature, the 7th legislative district was the one I'm seeking to return to as their legislator, has the most public housing of any, by far, it's not even close, of any other legislative district in the entire county. You have Colonial Gardens, you have Stuyvesant Charter, you have Birches over off of Flatbush Avenue, then you have Roundout Gardens down off 9W, and there's across the street, I still want to call Broadway East, but it's by another name now. But there are issues, particularly as it relates to some of the Kingston Housing Authority properties, and those folks over there, I believe, are underserved. Now, that doesn't immediately come under the jurisdiction of the county legislature, but certainly a legislator would have influence to assist with that, because there are certainly living conditions in those in those facilities. Now, we could argue whether or not government should be involved in housing, but if they're going to be, they have to do it right. And there's certainly some issues that the tenants in those buildings are coping with. And we have to face facts. Some of those buildings, like Stuyvesant Charter, for instance, I don't think were ever designed to, I think they're useful life when they were built was probably about 40 years, and we're going on 50 years that they've been there, and they definitely need some, if they're going to continue and remain as occupied dwellings, they need some work, and certainly the Housing Authority needs to get cracking on that. And that's something I'm definitely looking to focus on.
So we're approaching almost 8 o'clock here. We're here with Brian Woltman, who's running for county legislator. Brian, as we wrap up here, you know, you mentioned the word transparency, and I agree with you. That's like a lightning rod when a politician says that, but you can be transparent.
Oh, absolutely.
Right? And the question is, and it's funny you're here today, because Fran and I were joking earlier about her and I running for office at some point and just kind of having a time filler conversation. But, you know, it does take a lot of courage. Why did you decide to do it, and what if someone is listening and wondering who to vote for, why would someone choose you?
Well, thank you. I chose to run again this year to seek to return to the office for a couple reasons. Initially, it became quite apparent to me late last year that if I did not run for county legislature, that the race for the 7th district legislator would have been an uncontested race. And personally, I don't like uncontested elections. I have a policy. I only made one exception to this policy, and that was for Jeanette Provenzano, because I love her. But my policy is, if I go into a voting booth and I see an uncontested election, particularly a local election, I'll choose to skip that one. Because I think it's a disservice to the voter. So finding myself in a position to do something about it this year, I felt I needed to step up to the plate and do that. And additionally, there's a lot, as I've spoken already, there's a lot of things I would want to resume in the county legislature. I want to resume the work as it would be for transit. I want to vote in a manner that For instance, there was a vote this year. There were three resolutions, Resolution 198, 199, and 200. Anybody can look it up, Ulster County 2021 resolutions, where they were three separate school districts. As they were contracted with the Ulster County Sheriff's Department to have school resource officers in their schools. This was a request that came to the county from the districts. And those districts were Onteora, Rondout Valley, and BOCES. And I believe, I'm a strong believer in home rule. I would have voted to approve those school resource officers. The incumbent legislator in the district voted not to approve them. And the reason was, didn't have anything to do with the particular request. The reason had to do with his objection to having school resource officers in our schools in the first place. And he made that clear in his speech to the legislature, which I find, first of all, home rule is home rule. These districts requested it. The county has provided the service already very successfully. The sheriff's department has successfully provided these services. I think it's something that should continue. When I was in the legislature, I gave it 24/7. I not only did I attend every meeting of the committees I was on and the obviously the body, but I also made a point to listen to the audio for the meetings I couldn't attend or wasn't on the committee. I would listen to all the audios of recordings of these meetings so I could get a full depth and background of what I was ultimately going to be voting on when the legislature met every month. So I would think of myself as one of the very hardest working legislators that was in the body, and you know, I'm looking forward to resuming that work next year. There's certainly economic development is, we talk about it a lot, it seems like a big umbrella pie in the sky subject, but it really, it's nuts and bolts, it's getting on the ground. We look to reform the IDA. The IDA needs to, as I see it, focus on employment opportunities. They're looking now to backfill and do something with the Health Alliance or Westchester Medical, and I applaud those efforts. I hope it's not too late, but I want as economic development, that working with the IDA is one of the really big best tools we have in our toolbox to help propel local development, and I would like to see them and assist them in their work with that as it relates to shepherding them through the legislative process to approve whatever stimulus packages they agree on.
Well, Brian, thank you for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
Best of luck. We're approaching the top of the hour here. Dan,
thank
how's it?
Thanks for listening.
Thanks, Brian.
How's it doing out there? It looks pretty gray.
It does look pretty gray. I think we're still in for a couple hours of rain still.
All right. Looks like it's coming down pretty good. But,
Okay. Thank you. And we'll be back in about 8:02. Here's for some station breaks. Thank you for being with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio. Thank you for being with us here at Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM. It is now 8 o'clock a.m. exactly, and it's Monday, August 23rd, 68 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. And you are listening to Kingston Community Radio, WGHQ, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. This last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Central Hudson. We'll be right back after these messages.
Thanks for starting your day with Kingston Community Radio on 920 WGHQ AM Kingston and 92.5 W223 CR FM Kingston, New York. Magic 92.5.
Get ready to go with Central Hudson on an epic adventure at the Dutchess County Fair, August 24th through the 29th. Visit us at our main booth in Building C and say howdy to Zoltar the Fortune Teller, who will predict your energy future. Then pop over to Central Hudson's booth at K29 to score 10 LEDs plus a desk lamp for only $10. See you in Rhinebeck at booths C30 and K29. Central Hudson's mobile app has a new look. It's the place to view and pay bills with ease, Check your electric and gas usage to better manage your energy consumption to save money. And report an outage, anytime, anywhere. Use the app to easily submit your meter reading to avoid estimated bills. Download it today from the App Store or Google Play. It's free and easy to use.
Hi, I'm Paula Strang, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
And we're back. Thank you. This is WGHQ, AM 920, 92.5 FM, streaming online at mykcr.org. It is the home of Kingston Community Radio, 7 to 9 a.m. every weekday. It's Monday, August 23rd, and 68 degrees here in uptown Kingston. And, of course, it's 100% chance of rain today. That will be continuing, and there is still potential for flooding here and there. High of 73 today. Some clouds tonight, a slight chance of a rain shower, like a 20% chance of a rain shower tonight, a low of 64. And Tuesday, a few clouds from time to time, but it looks like it's going to be a sunny day tomorrow. And mostly clear Tuesday night, a low of 63. And Wednesday, a few clouds from time to time, high of 89 on Wednesday as well. And Wednesday night, mainly clear, a low of 69. This upcoming portion of Kingston Community Radio is brought to you by Herzog's. Stop by Herzog's Home and Paint Center in the Kingston Plaza for all of your home building, maintenance, and painting needs, and discover the difference of buying local. Sales ongoing at Herzog's.com. Let's get back to the on-air studio with Fran DePetrillo Savocca and Dan Gruner and our new guest.
Yes.
Thanks, Dan.
Good morning. And welcome, Christina, from Spa 21. We're excited to have you here.
Good morning. Thank you so much for having me.
Dan, if people have questions as they're listening to Christina, it's 331-9255.
You've got it.
Okay, great.
How's the birthdays? Do we have a birthday roster?
I didn't see any in there.
The folder's empty.
And we wish Bob Ryan.
We already wish Bob Ryan a happy birthday. I don't want to give him any more airtime.
The moo cow is sad. Okay.
If anyone else is having a birthday today, happy birthday. So welcome, Christina.
So Spa 21, tell us all about it.
So we are still alive and kicking and welcoming people who are working on their health and wellness and who are looking to grow in that part of their lives or just de-stress. We work with people who have chronic pain, who have chronic inflammation, those kinds of things, mm-hmm. and who just generally want to feel better.
And when we say Spa 21, it's not your average go in and put on a fluffy robe and get a massage type.
Yes.
Okay.
That's right.
Just so we're clear.
Yes. So we really think of ourselves a lot as a wellness center. Mm-hmm. So we're called Spa 21, but we're really in the space of wellness. Of course, a lot of spas are in the space of wellness. Our owner is French, and as I understand it, spa in France has a much broader meaning than it mm-hmm. does in America. So we're very inclusive in that way in terms of the kinds of things that we offer. Mm-hmm. A lot of our services are technology-based. In fact, all of our services are technology-based in some way or another. So we're using technologies to help bring the body back into a state of healthy functioning.
Mm-hmm. And because it's so technology-based, that's part of how you were able to stay open and help the community through COVID, because it's not really the hands-on and the place was spotless and you didn't really see another client when you were there. You were able to space that all out and still provide services.
Exactly.
Which is great.
Yeah.
And you have well-being coaching?
We do. Yeah. It's okay. One of our services that we're not necessarily yet known for.
Okay.
But we do offer it, and it's a really interesting service. It's also one of the things that makes us very much in the wellness space. Mm-hmm. So the well-being coaching that we offer is a the coaches, so myself and Dave, who work there, we are trained in a 16-part comprehensive program in well-being. And so coaches walk clients through that program. So it's really for people who are who realize that there's something in their lives that is not consistent with how they want to live. There's kind of a baseline or fundamental feeling of like there's something more for me, you know, in my inner life that I don't have right now. The program was designed by the Anthropedia Institute, which is a well-being education nonprofit. So what they did and did really, really well is they looked at all of the best research and practices in the field of well-being. And they compiled it and put together a really practical program in well-being. So it's something that is science-based, and at the same time, it's also very humanistic. It's, you know, very much sitting in a room with another human being talking about the big ideas, which I love. The big ideas, what gives our life purpose, what gives our life meaning, where do we want to grow, where do we feel weak, where could we be more resilient, those kinds of things. So the program, what Anthropedia did is they put together this program in a series of DVDs. So coaches actually go through these DVDs. We really treat them like the text almost, like we're studying a book together, but we do it visually instead of actually reading. We found that people would rather watch something than read most of the time. So we do that, and we kind of walk through these basic principles in well-being and how they can apply to a single person's life.
Mm-hmm. Can you give us an example of one of the components?
Yeah, I will. So one of the key components to well-being coaching is something we call the TCI, which is called, it's the temperament and character inventory. So at the beginning of a coaching relationship, we sit down and we the client does a personality questionnaire. So the temperament and character inventory measures our unconscious emotional drives. So the things that are driving us in our lives that we are not aware of. And the conscious ways that we construct our lives according to our values. So it's a really fascinating test. It was actually designed by a geneticist. So he's looked at the genetics of these traits in the human brain. And so he's measuring through the test, he's measuring the expression of these traits. The character is the, or sorry, temperament is the unconscious emotional drives that often direct our lives. And character is the more conscious ways that we construct our lives. So it's an interesting mirror to start a coaching relationship with because it's very specific and very concrete. And it's a way to look at areas of your life where you have conflict, but you don't understand why. So it's looking at, okay, well, what is unconsciously emotionally driving me in these conflicts? And so that gives us a place to start a conversation about ways to grow.
Yeah,
it's really fascinating. It's an amazing test.
Yeah.
It's one of those things that usually at the end of a TCI, it's, you know, you kind of feel like you've gone through some, you know, something significant with another person.
How long is the program?
So to do the entire, so it's a 16-part series.
Yeah.
To do the entire thing, it takes about 3 years.
Wow.
Yeah. When I say comprehensive, it is truly comprehensive. It is designed to touch every aspect of our lives. It's designed to address well-being in our lives in the body, in the thought, and in the soul or psyche. So when we say that, we're talking about like the more transcendent aspects of our existence, whether that's a connection to humanity or a connection to nature, or for some people it's a connection to God. So it's a way of, so part of it is looking at what is beyond our individual experience of the self. And some of it is very much about the individual experience of the self. Mm. So, yeah. Yeah. Of course, you don't, when you start coaching, you don't have to do the entire 16 parts of the program. We have people who will start and do four parts, and they'll do it for 9 months or a year. Or we'll do, you know, have someone do eight, and then they're like, you know what? I feel like I have done what I need to do. I feel great. I have addressed these things in my life that needed addressing. And then they'll go on their way. Sometimes they'll go on their way and then they'll come back. Mm-hmm. They'll say, you know what? Actually, I do want to finish. Yeah. I want to do the whole 16 parts.
That is comprehensive.
It really, really is. It is a journey.
Wow. That's really interesting. And I didn't know that that's offered right here at Spa 21.
Yeah. Yeah. It's so Anthropedia coaches, Anthropedia's trained coaches all over the world, in the Middle East, in South America, in France, in England, in Italy, in the United States. But there are only certain places right now in the United States where we have pockets of coaches, and New York is one of them. So,
and Kingston, New York is one of
them. And Kingston, New York is one of them. Yes.
Spa 21's been here for how long?
For 2 years.
2 years. Okay. Yeah.
We opened about 7 months, 6 or 7 months before lockdown. So we were already, you know, very much working in this space of, obviously, of wellness. That's what we wanted to bring. We did not anticipate that there would be this level of need.
Yeah,
when we opened.
That was actually going to be my next question, that I would imagine, unfortunately, that need has gone through the roof.
It has. It has. I mean, obviously, stress levels, anxiety levels, depression, all of that we're seeing increase exponentially, really. So I feel incredibly grateful that we have a place where we can go and address that, because I think one of the illusions in our society is that well-being is a luxury. It's something that is that it's the extra thing that you do after you've done everything else that you need. And I think our perspective is actually completely inverted. It is that well-being is the essential thing you need to do everything else you have to do.
I agree with you.
Good point. Yeah. Wow.
You know, and it's obviously a very delicate subject, but I think when you look at it the way you're looking at it, right, if we're not healthy mentally, mm-hmm. it's almost very, very difficult to be healthy in other aspects of our lives, right?
Absolutely.
And you know, you see it so, you know, in the last 18 months. I mean, I've always been I like to think of, a very independent and mentally strong person, and it's challenged me. Mm-hmm. You know, yeah. I'm not someone that ever sits home. I've just never been like that in my life. I've always loved to be out doing things, and then all of a sudden that goes away, and I'm like, whoa, you got to hit the reset button here and find something to do with yourself.
Absolutely. Yeah,
the going away part is what matters. I mean, because if you, I see this, you know, this foundation of well-being. I totally, you know, like understand what you mean by using that as the basis, because every little decision you make during the day makes a huge difference for the rest of your well-being. You know, you decide, oh, let's say, maybe I won't take a bike ride. Right?
Yeah.
And, well, let's take a bike ride. Yes. And that also increases your well-being. So, you know, like having a baseline is all important for every decision you make throughout the day.
Absolutely. And I think one of the questions is, what is driving those decisions? Is it a feeling of hope and vitality? Or are we coping? Right. So the foundation of well-being allows us to adapt and be resilient without this feeling of I'm just coping with the weight of my life or with the challenges of my life. It gives us a feeling of being equipped to deal with those challenges. And that, I think, is where the hope comes from. And to your point, Dan, about the well-being impacting the health of our minds, impacting every other aspect of our health, I think that's really true. I think the health, like when we have healthy thoughts, when we have thoughts that are informed by hope and love. And I think that our relationships are healthier. Our bodies are healthier. I mean, we know more and more all the time about the mind-body connection, right? When we are depressed and anxious, that impacts the body. When the body feels strong and resilient and healthy and vital, that impacts our thoughts. And so, you know, we're really not trying, you know, never trying to separate one out, but see the totality of the person in the totality of their lives.
And just the positive delivering of your message, right? It's, unfortunately, mental challenges carry such a negative connotation in our society, and I could go on for a long time about how that leads to so many other things that we see going on. But, you know, to Dan's point, let's go for a bike ride. Am I really going to go for a bike ride? Mm-hmm. We all know we're going to feel better if we go for the bike ride, yeah, and probably have some fun doing it, maybe run into some people, or, you know, not physically, but it's just the whole messaging is completely different.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I never want to minimize the seriousness of mental challenge. I mean, what I think is that more than ever, people need help. Right? There is a reason that people are so challenged. There is a reason that we're hurting in the way that we are. And so I think the most important thing is to realize that there is something, that there are things that can help us move through that suffering or move through that, you know, whatever those challenges are. And I do feel an enormous amount of hope for what we're capable of. If we can find our way to that place.
Mm-hmm. We need a whole hour with Christina. I think there was a second.
I need 3 years.
I know.
Yes.
Come on down.
3 years, yes. But like you were saying, because so there's unconscious, we're making conscious decisions each day, and there's this whole unconscious level that we're not even aware of, that we're not taking into consideration when we make these conscious decisions.
Well, and these don't help. Right.
Our phones.
Yeah. You know, people kind of forgot how to do this.
Yeah.
Right? Because we've lived on this for the last year and a half and haven't had to look people in the eye. And, you know, it's, you know, as anybody that has teenage kids, this is the nemesis of our entire being.
Holding up his phone for the listeners.
Although it is.
Dan's holding up the cell phone.
It is the ultimate tracking device when they're not answering your calls. But
there's pros and cons.
Yeah, but every, you know, because you're talking about, you know, the subconscious effect and, you know, how much is flashed in front of our faces all day long. And I was giving a presentation years ago to college business school students. And it was about the kind of, you know, how do you network in the digital world? And I found this short, and it proved my point. It was less than 3 minute long video and showed all the things that are going on in the social media, and that, you know, Facebook is bigger than the Germany, and it's just flashing all this stuff. Oh, right. And I'm watching the kids. Mm-hmm. And the whole premise of the video was to get their attention. And I watch. Not even 60 seconds in, kids are, they can't pay attention. So I said, what did you just learn? Tell me one thing you learned. There was like, whatever, 20 some facts buried in this thing. They retained nothing. And I said, now, you want to spend your day on your phone, or you want to get out and learn to talk to people? And I shared with them at the time, you know, I have 800, 900 followers on LinkedIn, whatever it is. How many business relationships came out of that? Zero. Mm-hmm. My two largest clients came from community events where I met the right people, connected me to the right person. I said, that's, you know, our subconscious is impacted so much that it affects our consciousness. You know, I tell my son, he's 13, I go, get out of the house. I don't care what you do, get out of the house. Mm-hmm. And then he goes for a bike ride or does whatever and connects with his friends. But, you know, I've been to Spa 21, and absolutely spotless, number one. And I was first time there. I did some type of, you had recommended some intro.
Intro session.
Highly, highly recommend it. I did the, I keep saying their name wrong.
It's the cryo. Cryo sauna.
Cryo sauna. Tell people about that. That was, you talked me down to being able to do it.
And he was glad he did it. In the end, there you go.
And it was, I was like, I didn't know what to expect. So could you tell people about that a little bit?
Yes. And then after cryo, there's another topic you wanted to talk about.
Yes,
and
okay.
Yeah. Oh, right.
And I'm going to need to scoot out, unfortunately, but I'm going to listen on my way to work.
Well, it was lovely to see you.
It was lovely to see you, too. We'll have to have you back again.
Quick description of cryo, and then we'll cover topic two. That was
okay.
Thanks,
I get sidetracked.
Thank you.
Thanks, Fran.
So the cryo sauna is a cold chamber, as you experienced. It does burn calories. It is a cold chamber that you stand in. It's cooled to around negative 200 degrees Fahrenheit. So what that does, you're only in it for a few minutes, but it addresses inflammation systemically in the body. It is a very powerful tool that we have to address inflammation. So it's great for chronic pain. It's an endorphin boost. And it's true that people can be a little bit nervous before they go in because it's negative 200 degrees.
Yeah.
That's an extreme situation for your body. But afterwards, generally, people feel fantastic. And as Fran pointed out, a single session burns about 500 calories. So it's a significant event for the body.
I have terrible arthritis in my ankle. And then, as we talked, I had back surgery a couple of years ago. So the left side of my body's not in great shape. And when my ankle's bothering me, it bothers an immediate relief. And I just felt, recharged. It was crazy.
That's really great.
And yeah.
That's what it's there for.
Yeah, it's so, as someone that is kind of not into new wave services... highly, highly recommend it, and I need to get back. So,
And you said you did an intro session, and I just want to say for people who are listening that an intro session is an hour of services for $50. So what we'll do is because we have a lot of things that people haven't tried, like the cryo sauna, we have a lot of far infrared treatments, we have a lot of, great tools that we can use that maybe people aren't as familiar with. And so if for people who want to try a few different things, then we can put together a program for someone. It's an hour of services. It's only $50. And it's a very inexpensive way to do the spa for the first time.
Yeah, I best $50 I spent a long time. So
that's great. I love hearing that.
We're kind of moving towards the middle of the hour. And I know there was one other area you wanted to touch on.
Yeah, so I wanted to mention that for a long time we weren't offering our facial renew service. We are right now, and we don't know how long this is going to last, of course, but for the moment we're offering it. And what that is, it's actually the same technology that we use for another service that's called Body Tone, but we're doing it with the face. And so what it is it is a machine that it sucks the skin up of the face, and it exposes it to radio frequency and infrared. And what it does is it increases microcirculation in the skin. It helps detoxify the skin. It helps increase collagen production and elasticity of the skin. And I think one of the things that we often don't think about is how important our skin is to the toxicity in our body. So, or the relative health of the body. It's a measure of the body's health. And so, obviously our skin is exposed to a lot of pollutants, and it's a way for our body to both absorb toxins and eliminate toxins. So what this service does is it helps detoxify the skin on the face, and if you do it as the body tone, the skin of the body. So it's a fantastic detox, and of course we all want our faces to be as healthy and radiant as possible. So I wanted to let people know that that is something that we're currently offering. It's a quick service. You're in and out in under half an hour. So yeah, I wanted to make sure to mention that.
Absolutely. And if you're just joining us, we're here with Christina from Spa 21, end of Lucas Avenue in Uptown Kingston. We've learned a lot about everything that you're offering there. you know, I think what I would describe it as someone that's been there. It's not what you think of when you think of a spa, you know, a traditional spa where you might go sit in a sauna and get a massage and wear a big robe and, you know, kind of a day of luxury. It is a day of luxury, but very therapeutic. You've talked a lot about, which I think is absolutely wonderful, the well-being program that, you know, I think is probably the most critical issue that our country faces. And so few people are willing to look at it through the lens that you are, that it is a, we all need help in one way or another, right? Let's not place stigmas on what that help needs to be.
Absolutely.
You know, quite frankly, I know me personally, I'm tired of it all. Tired of a lot of things, but, you know, I firmly believe if our intent is to help other people, and we could just get back to that, because that's what we've all, right?
Yes.
Isn't that ultimately why we're all here?
Yes.
If you don't want to help people, then you probably need to address that, right? But the more we can do for our community and for each other, it just makes us a better place. And, you know, I often, you know, talk to friends about, you know, why are certain people so angry? Well, I think we could understand why they are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right? There's something unhappy in their life.
Yeah.
And we don't always know what that is. You know, you often see that saying, you know, you don't know what somebody else is walking around with, right?
Absolutely.
And, you know, I think someone would quickly be comfortable talking to you about what they might be carrying in their head or in their heart, mm-hmm. right? Because both affect us. You know, I lost my mom at 28 years old. It was the hardest thing I ever went through. But I listened to someone who encouraged me to go talk to somebody about it.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And I did. And it was the best thing I ever did because I didn't realize how angry I was. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize how sad I was. Mm-hmm. I didn't realize how confused I was. Mm-hmm. But talking to someone pulled together those three things that they all tied together, and every which one of them was okay for me to experience. Yeah. But until I understood that I was experiencing, because, you know, I'm a 28-year-old guy. I'm not sad. The right. Hell I wasn't.
Right.
My mother was diagnosed with lung cancer and died 2.5 months later. You know, and I'm guilty because I was living in Boston at the time, and I had a tremendous amount of guilt that I didn't understand. Mm-hmm. But somebody helped me understand all that. And, you know, I would much rather be proud that I got help. If I didn't get that help, I'd be a mess right now. I'm kind of a mess anyway. But, I, you know, if I didn't, and I encourage people and I watch people. Like, I might sell insurance for a living, but I get paid to read people, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're genuine. I knew that 3 seconds after you sat down. And people will be comfortable talking to you. So I would encourage people to seek you out because, you know, particularly I think it's just a guy thing, right? I don't need any help. The best thing you could ever do for yourself is to get that help, whatever it is, mm-hmm. right? And I've watched friends, family that finally raise their hand for very difficult situations get help. I've watched others not. Well, guess what? The ones that haven't are way over here, and the ones that have are living a nice life.
Yeah. And I think that, you know, that movement towards getting help, whatever that help is a movement of strength.
Yeah.
Right? It's not a movement of weakness. It's a movement of strength.
It's heroic. Exactly.
It's the biggest, I think, moment of truth in someone's life to raise their hand and say, you know what, I need help.
Yeah.
And you know, like, I always look at the example of how I grew up. You know, my dad, he was a dentist, 13 years old. I'm one of four kids, the forgotten third. I was 13 years old and he had to sell his dental practice because he had back surgery that didn't heal properly. He's got a daughter who's second in his class, about to go to Villanova, another punk son and me, and then, family of four, our life never changed. Mm. But we're going to take a break. Christina, Spa 21, thanks so much. Check it out. It's a phenomenal place. super clean, super safe. So, and a lot of great stuff to offer. Thanks for coming in. Yeah,
thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, Christina. Spa 21. And thank you, Dan Gruner, so much. And thank you, Fran DePetrillo Savocca, for bringing us around to the bottom of the hour here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. 70 degrees right now here in Uptown Kingston. It's Monday, August 23rd, and we will be right back.
Thanks for starting your day with Kingston Community Radio on 920 WGHQ AM Kingston and 92.5 W223 CR FM Kingston, New York. Magic 92.5.
Get ready to go with Central Hudson on an epic adventure at the Dutchess County Fair, August 24th through the 29th. Visit us at our main booth in Building C and say howdy to Zoltar the Fortune Teller, who will predict your energy future. Then pop over to Central Hudson's booth at K29 to score 10 LEDs plus a desk lamp for only $10. See you in Rhinebeck at booths C30 and K29. Central Hudson's mobile app has a new look. It's the place to view and pay bills with ease. Check your electric and gas usage to better manage your energy consumption to save money. And report an outage, anytime, anywhere. Use the app to easily submit your meter reading to avoid estimated bills. Download it today from the App Store or Google Play. It's free and easy to use.
Hi, I'm Paula Strang, and I support Kingston Community Radio, and so should you.
This last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Herzog's. Stop by Herzog's Home and Paint Center in the Kingston Plaza for all of your home building and maintenance and painting needs. Discover the difference of buying local. And visit Herzog's.com. Sales are always ongoing at Herzog's.com. A little weather and forecast again for Kingston and vicinity. Rain likely today, of course, it's, duh, it's 100% chance of rain during the day. Later on tonight, though, some clouds and a slight chance of a rain shower, about a 20% chance, a low of 64. And Tuesday, we've got a few clouds from time to time, but it's going to be sunny with a high of 89 tomorrow. And tomorrow night, mostly clear, a low of 63. And no chance of rain, really, for Tuesday night. Wednesday, the same. A few clouds from time to time and a high of 89 for Wednesday. Let's get back to the on-air studio and welcome back.
Wow. All right.
Hey. So we're back. And Fran is gone. She had to go to work. So I'm going to fill in for Dan. Or not duh. Fill in for Fran and help Dan out here. Our next guest is Robert Baum. Bob is a good friend of mine and also did our wonderful signs here at the station. Bob was also a commercial realtor. You two know each other, right, Dan?
Absolutely.
Known each other for a long, long time.
A long time, right.
How in Kingston can you not? That's the wonderful, beautiful thing about Kingston. You know, everybody kind of knows everybody.
Absolutely.
When you want to get something done, like, you know, in the same day, that doesn't happen another.
You can reach out. It's a good family community. It always has been.
Well, that sign, remember when I needed that sign? I got that in, what, 2 hours?
Yeah.
I called you up at 8. I texted him at 8 o'clock. The sign that's outside on Lucas Avenue. One sign blew off, and then we decided, because they had their sign was too big. And Bob's like, because it was 36 inches. He's like, I'm going to put your sign here. And it was done. I called him at 8 in the morning. It was up before noon.
Yeah. Well, I've got to say, what's a realtor doing without a sign?
Right.
So I have my sign shop down in the basement, so I make whatever you need.
There you go. And you also did the signs for Raj's Deli, too, right?
Yeah. Raj is a good friend.
Yeah. He
keeps me in coffee.
That's how I found out about. He's like, you know who does those? Your buddy Bob. I was like, get out of here. Hey, Bob does signs, too. This guy
does everything.
Man of many tasks.
So, Bob, I'm interested to know, what are you seeing on the commercial real estate front?
It's a strong market, very strong. It's not quite the same as the residential market, in my opinion. The residential market is sort of out of control.
Yep.
dollars and cents wise. But speaking of dollars and cents, that's what I do. Commercial real estate has to make sense to the person who's wants to buy a property. It could be land, it could be a building, it could be a business. But the net income has to justify the price. And it's a little bit different than a house.
Yeah.
Somebody likes the house, it's beautiful, they like the ambiance, they'll pay what they want, what they need.
The residential side can be a very emotional buy.
Extremely.
The commercial side is a, as you said, dollars and cents, does it work?
Right, right. And dollars and cents comes into play whether you're buying or whether you're selling. And in the selling side, I'm schooled in 1031 exchanges. I'm not an intermediary, which is required for 1031. But I can refer people to that. And they need a good accountant and a lawyer, both of whom should be schooled in 1031 exchange.
Are you seeing... You know, from what I hear, buyers from out of town have their eye on Kingston.
Tremendous.
Yeah.
Tremendous number of buyers. I manage the leasing on two strip centers, one in Saugerties and one here in Kingston. And in many cases, we've been working 9-10 years to fill those spaces. And with the advent of COVID, we figured, boy, this is really going to tank.
Yep.
But what's happened is people are coming in from out of the area, and they're bringing business. They're bringing their businesses here, and they're looking to start new businesses. So right now I'm leasing three properties that have been vacant for over 6 years.
And those are, could you speak to the type of business? Well, that, you know,
sure.
Just like industry-wise, I'd be interested to know, you know, because, A, it's great people are coming here.
Right.
But, you know, for someone like me who's also in business, to understand what type of businesses are coming here.
Right. What we have karate, two karate schools coming in. We had a defunct laundromat downtown at the Rondout Plaza. It went out of business in 2015. And we have someone coming in totally doing a $300,000 renovation on the inside with new equipment, and they'll be open in November. Up in Saugerties, we have a child care facility expanding. The other major one we have going in is primarily an online business, but they're going to have a small retail store, and they make candles and what I call good feeling stuff, you know, the scents and that sort of thing.
Interesting. What do you know, because obviously there's a lot of talk in Uptown Kingston specific, and then, you know, the roundout we were talking about earlier this morning, in terms of, you know, activity in Uptown Kingston. It seemed like there was a flurry for a while. Is that still happening? Or I know a lot of those buildings have changed ownership.
And right. I think the buildings changed ownership at a time when the prior owners were looking to sell. And we had some people come to town who had the ability to pay cash, get the job done. And they pretty much to a person have spent a great deal of money renovating these buildings. So they're looking for new types of tenants to come to this community. I think there's been a little bit of an easing of that uptown, by all appearances anyway.
Yeah.
But I also see a settling of the businesses that have started. They're taking hold. They seem to have customers. They seem to have a business going now. And I think that's sort of an organic growth that's required to entice other people with businesses. It can't be all people who say, gee, I really wanted to have a business uptown. You need some other businesses coming who have established businesses and say, you know what, this is changing uptown, and we can find a slot there.
Yeah, and it's you're seeing a good mix too, right? I mean,
right.
Obviously Karen Clark Aiden's been the anchor of Uptown for God knows how many years now. But, you know, you have those two new, like, lunch slash restaurant, right. Kingston Bread Bar and that board. I mean, there's always a line outside of those. But then, you know, it's called, like, Upstate Capital Market, or it's a, you know, like, retail store. But I think, to your point, when you start to see the blend of businesses that can complement each other, and if we can ever get more parking in Uptown Kingston, I think that'll help.
Right. We could segue to the resistance to the parking garage in the Kingstonian.
You know, I'd be happy to talk about it, and I would share that, you know, I said to people back when there was that first wave of resistance, I said, well, you know, I guess if you're so against it, it was an open RFP from the city of Kingston.
Right.
Why didn't other people apply?
Right.
That seemed to kind of, what do you mean? It was an open RFP. If you have an other solution, and oh, I don't know, have $50 million to spend.
Sure.
On a private development that will include a parking garage, why don't you put in your proposal?
Right.
They didn't seem so angry at that point.
No.
They had a real hard time answering it. And then, well, what do you mean? I said, well, if you actually educated yourself on it, $50 million commitment by the Jordans and Benoras, what happens to include a parking garage that, yes, you need an offset for.
Yes.
And talk about, I went to college in Burlington, Vermont, and I say, if this project, or not, I'm not going to say if, when that project happens, Uptown Kingston becomes Little Burlington, Vermont.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Because yeah, you've got.
Great.
It'll be. Awesome, too. Every storefront will be packed. Every restaurant will be packed.
And you got plenty of parking. And 430 spots.
Oh, there's the $1 million ticket, the parking.
Yeah, of course. And
any real estate up there, in my opinion, well, I live four blocks from there, so I'm rooting for it.
Right, yeah, of course. And so am I.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's common sense. And the resistance is just unfounded as far as I'm concerned.
Well, it is. It's, you know, and it's like move the goalposts, right? Well, we don't want this. Yeah. So, well, now we're going to give away this 0.1 acre of land on the corner of North Front Street that nobody even knows where it exists, but we're going to make that the issue now. What happened to the storm drainage issue?
Right.
Or the mineral rock that was going to get dissolved? Or, you know, it's like I wish I had the time to – like, right? I just read about this stuff, but, you know, it's amazing to me. I mean, could you talk more about, like, you know, I just watched New York State, the challenges, say, for a developer or someone selling a property or buying a property. I mean, it just seems from, you know, the watchful eye that it's like an endless challenge.
It is, and it always has been. I've been.
God bless you.
I've been doing this for actually a long, long time, 30 plus years. I owned other businesses in between, but I've actually had a real estate license, believe it or not, since I was 26.
Jesus.
And I hate to tell you, but that's 50 something years ago.
You just told me his age when we were off before we got on the air, and I didn't believe him. I'm like, come on. I thought. I
mean, oh, he loves me. He loves me. He's just saying.
No. I did not think that you were that age. And I, you know,
back to the issue. The issue is I've been standing in front of boards, planning boards, for a long, long time.
Oh, my.
And,
some odd years.
And planning boards seem to be, in many cases, I won't point fingers, but many times they're people who don't really understand business. They had time to give to the community. They wind up on planning boards, but maybe they really don't understand the graphic nature of what they
what it entails.
Yeah, what it entails. So you have
so as a seasoned real estate veteran,
yeah,
of 50 years, have you seen any other time where there's been this much activity and interest in the area?
Well, no, and I'm probably not the right person to ask that because I moved here. I'm still a newcomer. I came in 1996.
Okay, you are a good benchmark then because that's after IBM left.
Right, that was after IBM.
Yeah. Right, so that's kind of when we hit the bottom.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Right. So whatever how many years that is now, 30-some years, Would you say this is the time where there's been the most interest in this area?
Yes, absolutely.
And do you think it's long haul or short haul?
Well, I think it's going to be a long haul.
Good.
And take a point at, take a look at the Hudson Valley Mall, which was thankfully purchased by the company in Georgia. And they are, I think, in it for the long haul. They apparently were not in it for a flip, which I initially thought might be the case. But, of course, they couldn't flip it anywhere.
So. Yeah.
It would be nice to get the mall up and running again. There's not really
right.
much in there now.
Well, many malls across the country are facing the same challenge.
Right.
And they're becoming mixed-use development areas also. Many of the malls getting torn down. And what's being built is mixed-use, meaning there's businesses, there's retail, there's medical facilities, there's community condominiums, apartment complex, grassy areas, nice picturesque situations. It's not just a mall with doors that open up and people go walking down concrete hallways. And I think that's what is beginning to take shape up at the Hudson Valley Mall. I don't know what the long-term plan is there. So
I think the mall, when that person got shot years ago,
yeah,
about 25 years ago, they kind of just started dwindling down from there. And then the thing that happened at the Ground Round, I mean, I'm not saying that those two things were the thing, but then the mall just died out. I mean, if Target and Dick's weren't there, I mean, Sears is gone, JCPenney's gone, Macy's right. is gone, Nuvance is up there now. But they've kind of cut off, their building is separate from
separate
the
building.
Mall. Now, I know they did a great job with the movie theater. If you've ever been to their new movie theater, I mean, sitting in those seats in the movie theater are awesome. I mean, you could literally fall asleep in it.
Well, that's
so
the
nice.
Problem. If I go to a movie, I have a hard time not falling asleep anyway.
You can turn the heat on if it's the summer. They're air conditioned, and it's relative. It's they're not expensive as you think they would be. So,
But the old school big box retail. Is, it's the Amazon effect.
Yes. And everybody's buying it online.
One of these mixed-use developments just opening in Danbury, Connecticut, and my company just took space in this new village, and a guy that runs our Danbury office was telling me about it, and it's like, he's going to work every day, and at his fingertips, he's got a driving range, which he loves because he's a golfer.
Yeah.
He's got, a gym, a spa, and there's condos at the other end of it.
Sure. Now, is that where the Ferris wheel was?
It's a gigantic building in Danbury. Right as you're coming into Danbury, you can kind of see it off the road. I forget. I haven't been there yet.
Uh-huh.
We're moving in, I think, November.
I see. We go to Trader Joe's over there.
Yeah, it's not far from there.
Okay. All right.
So it's the largest building in Danbury. I forget what the name of it is, but
I have to go over and take a look.
Yeah, it's sounds pretty incredible. So back to what we touched on, and kind of parlaying with the Kingstonian is, how do realtors, developers? I mean, I just go, how do you stick with this and get through all this to finally get to where, right? Because you're probably like me, you don't get paid until it closes.
That's right.
And, I mean, it's a tremendous amount of work.
Yeah.
Patience.
Patience.
A lot of patience.
restructuring plans, because you have to make it work for the community, because if it doesn't work for the community, they're going to be up in arms. And they'll put pressure on the planning boards and the approvals and that sort of thing. So I think that what has to happen is we have to be more realistic with time requirements for funding of projects. I've seen many projects die because it took 2.5 years to get approvals, and by the time the 2.5 years were over, either the people who wanted to do the work retired, said, screw it, I'm going to Florida, or maybe they lost their funding. It happened in New Paltz 35 years ago. I watched that happen downtown New Paltz. A guy had a plan for the waterfront that became the brew pub down there now, ultimately, and he was held up for over 2 years.
Yeah.
And he ran out of funding. The banks pulled the funding back. We got into a different economic period,
yep.
And the banks pulled the money. And maybe that was a saving to him. because nobody could plan 2 years prior that the economy was going to tank.
So. Now, is it, I mean, and then you run into in this area, you know, you run into environmental issues.
More so now than before. We have to look for artifacts and archaeological situations, and nearly all properties now have to have some sort of an archaeological approval. Farms, same thing. Environmental issues. One of the biggest problems with farms are the chemicals that were used over the last 50 years in apple orchards and so on. And again, New Paltz, where I lived for 16 years, is an example of that.
Yeah. So. We were talking earlier this morning about the county taking hold of Tech City, you know, and I believe you can't fix a problem until you get rid of the problem.
Right.
You know, I certainly hope that's a good thing. Do you have any thoughts on what's going on out there?
I don't really. I've been distanced a bit from that because at one point I had wanted to represent Ginsburg to sell the property. We were not given that opportunity, which in hindsight is good because it was kind of fruitless effort for a number of reasons, which I won't go into all of them. But
well, we only got 8 minutes. So.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, yeah. Well, it's going to take a large plan, and I don't have an idea about what that's going to be.
Yeah, it's the massive, you know, talk about cleanup.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
That in of itself is going to be millions upon millions. I was in one of the buildings, was it last winter? The Kingston Youth Soccer League has taken space in one of the buildings, and they put down turf, AstroTurf, so you can, we would rent it for lacrosse training. And, you know, you just look around, and I mean, hey, these buildings are absolutely massive.
Yes.
And they need a lot of work.
A lot of work, right.
And but, you know, I think what to your point earlier of, you know, what we're talking about with Kingston, if the more of Tech City we can get brought back and maybe do it in chunks, it can need it or, you know. Well, I won't even mention his name because I did hear his name being involved in that, which would not be a good thing in my opinion. But so what are you seeing? Interest rates are still low. That's helping.
That's helping a great deal. There's also more money available. There's been a lot of money made in this last 2 years, 3 years. Yeah. And there's private funding available. The interest rates are good. They were, the private money is 7 to 10%.
Really?
Which is not too bad.
Yeah.
If you look at history, yeah. if you compare it to a 3.78 residential mortgage, it's pretty expensive. But, you know, looking at businesses, there's a lot of money available for businesses.
You know, oh, and that also on the private funding property. Is a lot less complicated, too.
Yes.
You know, yeah. That's interesting.
Now, generally, the private money is maybe a small group from a single person to a small group who
yeah.
come together. It isn't, well, the bank here and the headquarters is in California, and we got to get approvals down the line for this.
Yeah, and it's interesting. My son and his friends play golf up at Woltman, and you know, I've been up there recently, and the place is just booming.
Yeah, yeah.
And I view that as a tremendous sign because, you know, as we all know, a couple of years ago, Woltman was on the brink.
Right, right. It was.
And I mean, I just
and people had to come in and kick in money to save it. If I
yeah,
remember
a bunch
correctly.
Of a bunch of members.
Local people. I know a few people. Yeah, yeah we yeah, all know. Right.
And they've done a tremendous job. I mean, they redid the pool. They put in a beautiful bar outside. On that patio where there used right. to just be nothing.
Right.
And I heard they fixed up the restaurant a little bit too, didn't they?
Yeah, I guess quite a bit. I haven't eaten there this summer. No, I did once, actually. It was good. But you could just, the foot, and I don't know anybody there.
Right.
Which,
yeah,
it's open
new
to
members.
The public now too, which it used yeah. to not be. Yeah. It used to be only
and
private.
Are you still a member of 12 Skill?
I've been a member of 12 Skill 25 years or
I
so.
I heard you guys are completely full.
We are completely full. A year and a half ago, we had 180 members. We've got over 320 now.
Wow, that's awesome. Yeah. That is unbelievable. We've had a great board
over the last 3 years who have done a tremendous
job.
That's great. We have, speaking of the pool, has been redone.
My brother told me.
Right. It's in great shape. The clubhouse is good. We've got new equipment on the golf course. The golf course is being tended to properly.
You can't be shanking them on that golf course. You got to hit them straight.
You
got to be a good golfer to golf at Twasco.
Well, what we do is if you have a pretty hefty draw on a ball or a duck hook, you know, you got to tee off the number one tee and face Wiltwick, and it'll go straight.
That was what I should be doing. I played at the Kiwanis tournament there. 15 years ago with Cameron Rylance, Chris Burns, and Mark Akeem. And I tell you, I was hitting – guys were just like, what are you doing? You're on my fairway. I'm like, I'm sorry. I can't hit him that straight. Get me from 100 yards outside the pen, and I can stick it right in the green.
Yeah.
On the tee box, dude, you better look out.
Well, Qualcho's a nice place. We have little porch and with the awning, and I sometimes will go over there at noontime and just sit and take a little break and just look out in the golf course.
And what's a full membership to go to Twasco for the year? I'm just curious, because I know what Wiltwick is, and I know what Calabar is. Is it 800, 1,000? Is it somewhere?
No, it's about 1,700, 1,800.
And that's for the full membership? For you and your wife?
Full.
Everything.
Well, yeah. No, but we have senior men.
Oh, okay.
So we're a little bit different category. Right.
The full golf for an adult is somewhere 1,700, 1,800.
Yeah, right. All you got to do is just call up for a tee time, comes with a cart, everything. You don't have to pay anything.
We don't have tee times.
No, really?
No. In fact, our leagues this year filled up. We have a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And Thursday night league, we have a Wednesday day league also.
Wow. So you got to play golf. So basically it's play golf on the weekend at Twasco if you remember.
Well, it's funny because we were down there for a couple of years, and I get it. My son, there weren't any kids his age there. Right. Like my brother's kids are younger. There's a whole group. And the only time I could get on the golf course was Sundays at like 3:00.
Right.
I'm like, wait a minute. Paying like $1,800.
Right. I want to play golf when I want to play. Right, yeah. But they have a lot of leagues there. I know somebody that's in a Twasco league.
And that's the thing. Like, I wasn't at a point where I was ready to be in one of those
leagues. It's a big commitment. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And,
you got to be a good golfer.
I'm just happy to hear that it's booming. And
it is.
Yeah, no, that's 320 members is a lot. I mean, that is.
And it's nice. We have a good crew.
Oh, it's just the nicest. You go down there by yourself and have a good time.
Right.
That's right.
Right.
You know?
All right, well, we're down to the last minute mark. Dan Gruner, thank you for filling in today. Normally it's a medical Monday, but you and Fran did a tremendous job. Bob, thank you for coming in.
Thank you for the invitation.
Everybody stay nice and dry. Tomorrow it's looking like a sunny day, but
today it's Tuesday and Wednesday are going to be nice.
Have a good day, everyone.
Thanks.
Thank you, and thanks, Lawrence, a very special thanks to Robert Baum and Dan Gruner for being with us today. It was a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful show. And you are with us here at KCR, Kingston Community Radio. It's now 8:59 a.m., and it's Monday, August 23rd, and 70 degrees here in Uptown Kingston. This last portion of Kingston Community Radio was brought to you by Ulster Savings Bank. Many locations throughout the Mid-Hudson Valley, one near you. And thank you for sharing the morning with us and participating in Kingston Community Radio, KCR, AM 920 and 92.5 FM, and streaming online at mykcr.org. Talk radio at its best. Inspired discussions of, by, and for the community. And we welcome you to be with us tomorrow morning at 7 a.m. for a terrific Tuesday. Until then, we wish you every success in growing and developing Kingston and all our neighboring communities. We now return you to Magic 92.5.
Why must I be a teenager in love? I cried a tear.